Critical metrics, to be sure, but none the measure of the man that we are here to celebrate. The great Irish poet, William Butler Yeats, once quipped of his father that being Irish, he had an abiding sense of tragedy that sustained him through temporary periods of joy. A description that one might assume applied doubly to an Irish Jesuit named McKeown. But this was not the case. To know my dad was to know a man who found joy, great joy in life, who embraced the various roles he had the opportunity to play. At times, a beloved son, a brother, scholar, teacher, pastor, humorous, humanist, friend, husband, lover, father, and most recently, granddad. All of these he pursued with an open, loving heart. And though his faith in religion waxed and waned at various points in his life, his faith in humankind, in friends, in family, remained steadfast. His heart never wavered on any of us. Dad taught us all so much. Growing up, he taught us there were things children should never touch. Like drugs and alcohol and thermostats. He taught us the consequences of pulling a suspiciously offered finger. We practiced art of a deafening whole body dad sneeze and groan inducing dad jokes, whose genius I have only recently begun to appreciate with my own children. Intentionally or not, he taught us that most aspects of 1970s fashion had absolutely no business making their way into the 1980s, especially 4-inch inseams on tennis shorts. He taught us that it is in fact possible to purchase a brand new car with absolutely no option packages, power windows, power steering, air conditioning, or anything that resembles comfort or convenience, as long as it was, if that meant paying above, sorry, the Consumer Reports recommended price. And he taught us that no matter how full a dishwasher may appear to the uninitiated, it was always possible to fit just one more item in there if you unloaded and reloaded. He taught us to recognize our errors and to be the third to admit our own mistakes. Sorry, first. Still working on that. He also infused us with his love of reading, of learning, Mother Nature, and especially of people. Through his pastoral and secular careers, he embodied the Jesuits' creed of cura personalis, caring for the whole person, especially for the least among us. That could also explain his fondness for Doug. He gave up himself. He gave up himself without hesitation, without expecting anything in return. It was just his nature, his heart. Few in this room have not been on the receiving end of a phone call thoughtful for Mike, or a caring, often handwritten note. He taught us all, and we learned whether we realized it in the moment or not, to think now of how much more we owe than we can give. Though, like any true Irishman, his life was not free of tragedy, losing his father to a heart attack as a young man, as a young boy. His mother as a young man, his sister to the pernicious cruelty of Alzheimer's, while also managing his own decades-long struggle with heart disease, a disease that attacked the very organ that made Mike, Mike. But he was never alone in that battle. With him always was Sally, Mom, me, his love. His grace, our grace, his heart personified. Oh, what a union began those many decades ago on the sidelines of Preston Soccer. Doug, Lindsay, Stephen, Kate, myself, we all conspired to bring them together. But honestly, even our best efforts, like pretending to be asleep when they came home from a date so that they just have to spend the night. Foolproof logic. Such efforts are largely performative. For once they met, the die was cast. The only force that could match Dad's love for her was hers for him. The famed Austrian psychiatrist and Holocaust survivor Viktor Frankl wrote in his memoir, "Happiness cannot be pursued. It must end soon. It must ensue. It only does so, as the unintended side effect of one's personal dedication to a cause greater than oneself, or as the byproduct of one's surrender to a person other than oneself." Dad and Sally surrendered their hearts to each other. And happiness? Oh, yes. It ensued. Their love was too great for just the two of them alone. Their full hearts couldn't help but spill over to fill the lives of their children and grandchildren, their extended families, their pets, even Wally. And their dear, kind friends. Dad placed such great value on his friendships. Some of my fondest memories with him were when he would invite me for an outing with his men's group, or his map boys, or just a visit with an old friend who was in town. The official purpose was always twofold. First, to solve all the world's problems. Second, to diligently sample and carefully appraise the world's finest beers. Some more than once, just to be sure. Now, some of you may assume that the latter might have impeded progress on the former, and the world's problems do remain, but there were great truths and great laughter surfaced in the attempts, and bonds forged, which are now, as you saw earlier, unbreakable. It was a privilege just to witness it, to experience their mutual love and respect, to see Dad in his element, to laugh beside him. Is there any greater fun than making your dad laugh in front of his friends? Mike McKeown was not one to seek glory, but when I look out into this room and see so many of his friends' faces, I can't help but return to the poet Yeats. Think where man's glory most begins and ends, and say my glory was I had such friends. Glorious indeed. Dad reflected often that every day after his heart attack in 1992 was a gift, a precious gift of time with Sally, with his children and grandchildren, with his beloved brother Tom and sister Sally, with his family and friends in this room and beyond, a gift he never took for granted. He never expected his heart to survive and serve him as long as it did. On paper, those clinical numbers and tests that we've been so focused on of late told of a flawed and weakened heart. But nothing could be further from the truth. His heart was the strongest thing about that man. And when I look out into this room,